Hey everybody, here is your homework for the weekend. And the reason why I'm doing this rather than doing another extended tutorial is you're getting the material down really well. You're being able to utilize the material as long as you're utilizing it exactly the same way I present it in the tutorial. And that's what we've got to move away from. We've got to move towards making the information transferable in a way that you can play with it and create with it, because you now understand enough of this tool that you can really begin to use it in your own explorations. But if you have a creative idea, you need to be able to not just utilize the tools in the way shown in the tutorial, but utilize them in your own personal idiosyncratic artistic way so that you can build your own ideas. So what I want you to do is I want you to do an exercise where you create five variations using the information that you already know, but each variation should look as different as possible from the material presented in the tutorial. This is going to give you a way in which to stretch your thinking about these tools and hopefully accidentally discover some interesting ideas, but also be able to begin to realize things that you imagine. So we'll start with our jit.world, and you'll want to name each one of these separately. So I'll call it HW1, since this is going to be homework number one. And these can actually all be combined into a single project. So we'll say file, new project, homework. Just make my new files right within my project. That way any audio files you use or any model files you use can also be included in the project. So I'll call this homework one and make my world homework one. And then you just start with this as the canvas, you know, and if it helps you to make it be white, you can always do erase color 1111, which will give you a blank artist's canvas, and begin to start thinking about these tools not technically but creatively. So let's just do a jit.gl.gridshape. And of course you can use a model for this now that you know about models, and I think probably most of you are going to want to. But we'll just start with some spheres, because you know the same principles can be applied to whatever shape that we're working with. I'm going to start with a cube actually. Say at shape cube, and jit.gl.multiple, and we'll do position rotate x y z, and until this bug is fixed in Max, use rotate XYZ always as your second GL param. That seems to improve the performance of rotate XYZ. Scale and color. Bind those together. And jit dot noise 3, float 32, 100. Do 20 by 20. And more, you're just going to start working probably in a single jit.gen with multiple outlets. We've been working with multiple jit.gens, and that's totally fine, but it's also convenient to, particularly when you're working with a jit.gl.multiple, just to have four outlets of a single JIT.gen. And again, this is one of the places where you start varying from the tutorials. You know, if this is a more efficient way for you to work and it's one that you understand, then do it that way. You can see how this is already a much less cluttered screen to be dealing with than we've had in the past. So I'm gonna start out with something simple and comprehensible to you. Rotation can be nothing. Scale needs to be something. And color. I'll just make the color the same as the noise and see what that gives me. See, already, right? Already, I've got something interesting that looks quite different from other things we've created, because these cubes are all on top of each other and just rendering as abstract areas of color. And that's quite neat. You know, since I'm just experimenting with shape, I'm going to do this with the JIT.gl.handle, just so I can don't have to set up all of that additional camera stuff. And as I pointed out in the last video, JIT.gl.handle is a little bit dangerous once you start working with camera. But this turned out pretty interesting. It made a cube of cubes, and if we zoom in on it, we can see that they're not all exactly in the same position. They're kind of overlapping each other, and we got a neat sort of array of. Ah, I see. Because I made a JIT.noise 2. That's why. JIT.noise 3 is going to give us a bit more three dimensionality. So I've got this sort of rainbow-colored Borg cube. That's neat. And the question is, once I have something that's working like this, where can I go from there? That's going to be interesting. Don't arrange these randomly according to the noise, and I arrange them according to the signed normal positions spread out over 10 meters. Ah, okay, so now I've got something different and quite interesting, and that's, really, I can go back in here and change this back to what I had previously and just say, that's pretty interesting all by itself. And I'm going to save that as homework answer number one, because I haven't seen this before. I haven't made this before. And I like it. So that's my homework number one. And then I'll just save as homework number two and make my next variation as homework number two. So this time I'll snorm it and spread it out over 10 meters. And now I've got something very different. Now you might be tempted, so I have to hit this button every time. You might be tempted to hook up this JIT.noise to the middle outlet of JIT.world, as we've done so many times. And wow, what is going on? That's totally insane. Why is this happening? And that's because jit.noise generates new random numbers every time it receives an impulse. So in order to avoid this problem, if we would just need to stick a jit.matrix in the middle here and hit that. That way we can put a bunch of random numbers in there, and the same batch of random numbers is being output every frame from the jit.matrix to the jit.gen, and it won't be replaced with new ones until I explicitly click. But that said, I'm going to call this homework assignment number two, because again, I've created something I haven't seen before. Now, all right, I might do this a little bit differently. If it was me, this will be a little tutorial then, because this is something we haven't looked at. We've looked at it a little bit. We've looked at the counter object, right? Counter just counts stuff. So for instance, here we're counting frames. And every time a frame goes by, the counter counts up. But counter can be given a range to count within too. So we can say count from 1 to 10, for instance. And then it's just gonna count over and over from 1 to 10. Now, why would I want to do that? Well, maybe this flashing is a little bit too fast. So if I do a counter 1 through 10, and then I say, we haven't looked at equals, so we'll look at equals. Equals is a double equal sign. So when the count equals 10, and then when we want something to happen on a condition, we say togEdge . So now our colors are changing every 10 frames, and you wouldn't have necessarily known how to do that, but what I'm encouraging you to do, what I'm pushing you toward doing here is finding a sense of discovery. So even though these, you know, this is me discovering using the tools that I know. You should discover using the tools that you know. You know most of what's here. I just added the counter and the equals. So when the count equals 10, so every 10th frame, do this thing. One thing I just recently learned, it may be a new Max 8 thing, is that togEdge is actually now built into the change object. So we use the change object, and the second outlet of change is the same as the left outlet of togEdge. So there's one less object you need to know. You don't actually need to use togEdge anymore. You can use change. Just know that if you want an event to happen when the condition is met, use the second outlet. So I'm going to save this as homework number two, and save it as homework number three, and move on, you know, to try to make something even more different. So I'm going to get rid of this whole structure here, and what else can I do? Well, I'm not doing anything so far with my scale, so I could do something with my scale. So why don't I swizz the Y from my random numbers coming in, and I'll make the heights of my cubes random. Ah, I see what's happening. But I like it. It's not what I had in mind, but it's pretty interesting, because the heights, I thought that they were going to be like buildings, but instead they're quite like something else. They're the heights in this XY grid, right? So accident, you know, it's an accident. Even for me, this was an accident. I didn't know it was going to turn out this way, but I like it. And these colors are kind of garish, so maybe I can do some. Whoops, maybe I can do something else with these colors. I'm just using the raw random values. What if I, for instance, what happens if I send norm to the colors? I'm going to hook this matrix up here so I can continuous output. So that's interesting. Right, I get red and green. Why? Because my normalized colors are 0 to 1 on the x-axis and 0 to 1 on the y-axis. So red and green here are a factor of, here's 0, 0, here's 1, 1, here's 0, 1, meaning no red and maximum green, and here's 1, 0, meaning maximum red and no green. So I'm seeing my coordinates as color. Well, that's kind of neat. So what if I then take the blue out of my randomness and I'll swizz the X and the Y to get my red and green from norm, but then I'll let my blue be totally the result of the random number generator and see what that does for me. Whoa, okay, so this is, you know, it's a much more interesting color palette happening there. Blue is random, but red and green are patterned, and it's still a little bit garish. So maybe I just multiply by some smaller value to get something that's, yeah, I've reduced the red content there. So it's 1/3 as much red, and now it has kind of an undersea look. So that's really beautiful. I'm gonna be very happy with this and call this variation 3, because it really does look quite different. Even though I haven't even varied from the cube yet, I'm still using the cubes. Maybe I'll make one more difference with this. What could I do? I could make these very deep. For instance, I'll just make them really deep in the Z dimension. Now see what I have here. See what that looks like with lighting turned on, lighting enable 1. Ooh, all right, you know, something really, really different, kind of interesting, digital looking. And I'm just gonna do one more variation and then let this go, because I'm just gonna say, you know, anytime you, basically anything in sufficient quantity is interesting. So I'm gonna take this and double it, and I'm gonna do at poly mode 2:2 to draw it as dots and see what that does for me. Can't really see it happening. There should be dotted versions of this in there. So let's go into the gen for this and let's just make everything slightly larger. And let's change the color to white so it stands out a little bit more. Aha! All right, now I'm seeing something potentially interesting. I've got these sort of windows in the cubes. And what can I do further here? Let's take a look at the attribute and see if there's any attributes here that might be fun to play with, like, ooh, point size. What if I make these points bigger So that's interesting. You know, I've got windows sort of in my world here. I've made it a bit too big. I want to make it just big enough. Let me get rid of that size addition. See what happens if I just size them the same. Yeah, my points are organized on the surface of the objects. I can change the size of the. Wow, okay. See, I'm getting into really unusual, interesting stuff here, that I did not know, you know, was possible. I'm not sure I love it. But it's there, as another variation. Do point size 2, and maybe make these red and crank up the dimensionality. So there's a lot more of them. Huh, okay, so that now I'm getting somewhere kind of interesting. I've created this red glow inside what's now a very cartoon-looking cube, and the red glow is in fact made of these points, these dots. So I'm quite happy with that. I'm going to save that as homework 3. And so I want you to go and make 5 variations, and don't, you know, don't follow what I'm doing in terms of the technique, but follow what I'm doing in terms of the spirit of play and experimentation. Make things that look different from each other using what you know, and you know, see if you can surprise yourself while still having a sense of understanding about what you're doing. See, I've gotten in just 3 steps, I've gotten something really quite far, and still I haven't even, you know, I haven't even used a model. I'm still just working with basic cubes, but they're pretty interesting. And the other thing you want to do is you want to make sure that you add any new files you create. If you didn't create them using the plus button, because I created them using Save As, I need to add the existing files, homework 2 and homework 3. Now they're all in there. Just to make sure they're all in the same place, I'm going to consolidate, and then this project is what you would compress and then send to me. So make 5 of those, have fun with it, make things that are interesting and surprising to you, and then of course always make sure that you can open them back up and get them back. So there's my number 1. There's my number 2. Well, crazy, I forgot about that one. And actually, I want to rename these so they can be open at the same time. HW2 grid shape, HW2 multiple should actually have HW2 in it too. Any of your GL objects should be specific about what they're referencing. And then HW3 should be world called HW3, and my multiples should be HW3, and my grid shapes should be HW3. Basically, any GL object, you want to specify the world in the name. And so I go back to HW1 and make sure. And this is going to keep things from getting confused when you have multiple windows open at the same time. In fact, your handles also should specify what world they're a part of, so that you're actually controlling the correct world. And I know that these connections should do that for you, but it's good to be explicit. Particularly now in Max 8, you can draw to multiple contexts, so it's extra important that you. That you have things specified. So my world is HW3, my handle is HW3. I don't need to do it for my noise. I don't need to do it for my matrix. I don't need to do it for my gen, but I do need to do it for my multiple and my grid shape. All right, great. So have fun with that. Email me with any questions, and I'll see you in class, or I'll look forward to hearing your questions and comments on the YouTube channel. Thanks a lot. Take good care. Bye-bye.